It was about a year ago when, due to recommendation of one of my friends, I started JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. To be honest, the first part was a bit boring and cliche, but it still had its charm, and that's why I continued on to the third season, where I thought about dropping it. Repeating the sentence feels really strange, as after 140 books, 170 episodes of anime, 5 games, and hundreds of articles and videos, no piece of art has impacted my life, has impacted me more than JoJo's. Now that I'm thinking about it, the fact that the JoJo franchise, which has engulfed a pretty important period of my life, could have easily not existed, frightens me. But unfortunately, no such thing happened, and I'm here to tell you all about it. I'm making this video, or series of videos, more than anything for myself, a kind of love letter to the series as a whole, and a wiki-esque video for emergency situations. No matter if you've experienced JoJo or not, you're completely welcome to join me in this journey as I explore all parts of the first trilogy and tell you about the stuff you've probably missed. I'm Shy, and thanks for watching my video. If you've been in the anime and meme community, or hell, even breathed on the internet, you've probably seen these pictures. It took me a long while to understand that all of these are from an anime called JoJo, and even now, if a sentence on the internet has the word Dio in it, a grenade of Kono Diodas, or you're approaching me's is gonna explode in the comment section. A lesser known manga, which even the author had no hopes for in terms of an anime adaptation, has now reached international fame and connected people throughout the world. But why is it loved? Or why do so many diehard fans defend it to their last breath? Answering these questions is near impossible, but still I want to start with the lovable creator himself, Mr. Hirohiko Araki. Hirohiko Araki was born in 1960 in Sendai, Japan. As told by himself, he spent most of his childhood locked up in his room surrounded by manga such as Watari, Harisuma Kaze, and even his father's art books. It was here that he found his love for art and storytelling, but it was only at 4th grade where he drew his first manga, and with the encouragement of one of his friends, he continued on, until submitting his works for different publishers when he was in high school. Unfortunately, all of them turned him down, but maybe it was because of fate that he found himself in the shuisha offices, where he met an editor willing to give his manga a chance. It wasn't all fine though, as the editor severely criticized the manga page by page. However, suggested that young Hirohiko would send it to the Tezuka Awards, an award ceremony for young authors. That manga ended up winning second place and was called Poker Under Arms, Mr. Araki's first official work. After 6 years full of trial and error, being influenced by his love for Western movies and also the unusual art of Paul Gauguin, the first part of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure called Phantom Blood was born. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Part 1 Phantom Blood was published in 1987 Japan and managed to make it to the front cover of the first Shonen Jump issue that year. The story takes place in the late 19th century England, where Jonathan Joestar alongside his Joe Bros, Speedwagon and William Zeppeli has to defeat his evil stepbrother Dio. The first thing you've probably noticed is that almost all the characters are named after old school rock bands, songs or singers. For example, William Zeppeli is based on Led Zeppelin, of course, and Dio Brando based on the rock band Dio. Araki has stated that this makes his characters easier to remember, and it's rare for someone to have a made-up name. But more importantly, it leads to the fanbase discovering a lot of new songs and artists, and also destroying their comment section. I for one love listening to the songs referenced while reading the manga, and finding the cool little connections each character had to their songs. But what about the anime, Shy, you may ask, which you probably didn't, but still. Well, my friend, there was actually another anime adaptation of Phantom Blood besides the 2012 version, which we will talk about more into the video. You see, for the 25th anniversary of Hirohiko Araki working as a mangaka, an animated movie based on the events of Phantom Blood was created by Studio App, the same people who had made the Stardust Crusaders OVAs. However, if you search the name of this movie on the internet, it's impossible to find a website for watching it, or even a physical version. This cinematic film is officially considered as part of lost media, as it is said that Mr. Araki himself banned the release of it. There's quite a debate on whether this actually happened or not, but no matter, one thing that everyone seems to agree upon is that Mr. Rocky was unsatisfied with the film and disappointed that one of the major characters, Speedwagon, didn't receive enough screen time and the overall feel didn't fit the manga. The footage you're seeing now is from the scraps and pieces fans have put together. Link in the description if you want to check it out. I don't necessarily disagree with Mr. Araki's opinion, as it is a movie based on his work, but still, I'm sure it was made out of love for the amazing work he had been doing for 25 years. It may not have been the best, but I still feel like tons of fans would have enjoyed it. There were rumors here and there about the movie making a return, but they were all from years back, and honestly, I don't think they meant anything. But I mean, Jonathan Joestar's voice actor from the movie came to be Diavolo's voice from part 5, so at least some good came out of it. Although we can't get our hands on the movie itself, something else was released along with it that genuinely I wish it was banned instead. The 2006 Phantom Blood video game. As I've said before, people oftentimes bring up the Phantom Blood movie when talking about part 1, but something they always forget is that a godforsaken game was also released along with it for the PlayStation 2. I don't consider myself a quote-unquote hardcore gamer, but I usually finish my games on the hardest difficulty, and the truth of the matter is, I couldn't go past a tutorial in this game. From the 30 or so minutes I've experienced, I can safely say that whether intentional or not, this game is really fucking bizarre. Not only does Jonathan handle like an astronaut with tons of stones stuck to him, but your enemies refuel their health meters so fast you can barely get up and attack them. From what I've seen on YouTube, the game follows the original story pretty well, but the anime and manga have made experiencing Phantom Blood so easy, I see no reason for playing this 16-year-old broken game. And speaking of anime, let's talk about the new JoJo's anime. That fucking transition. But seriously, let's talk about the new David Pro anime. As I've said before, for the longest time, Mr. Araki believed that the weirdness of JoJo couldn't be properly translated into anime format. The sheer strangeness of it, coupled with the wacky characters and battles, had made the job of adapting it extremely difficult for studios, and the OVAs hadn't quite scratched that itch of a proper JoJo adaptation. Fans were waiting for years for a studio to finally take up the challenge, and in the October of 2012, it happened, when David Production released the first episode of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Phantom Blood, which not only managed to satisfy die-hard fans of the series, but attract many new ones. Although most of its ideas were kinda cliche and old-fashioned, the way they were implemented in the story had made it quite engaging, which the amazing soundtrack also helped with. JoJo is incredible and magnificent. Large, muscular men who go toe-to-toe with each other gives the viewers that sense of power that the manga did 25 years ago, alongside works like Fist of the North Star and Dragon Ball. You have Jonathan Joestar as a main character, who in more ways than one is the exact embodiment of righteousness and good, who has to fight the source of all evil, his brother Dio. These two, alongside the other characters in the story, have no motivation for anything aside fighting each other, and pretty much everything boils down to good and evil, which honestly, I don't mind that much. Now that I'm inclined with the weird nature of JoJo, it has a certain charm to it, watching my favorite characters having a battle to the death with each other, although almost all the people I've recommended to have major problems with the story. But still, I highly recommend you don't skip parts, as witnessing the progression in both the art style and storytelling abilities of Mr. Araki is a lot more enjoyable having followed it from the beginning, and besides, who doesn't love Dia? I also highly recommend watching the super eye-patchable videos on JoJo as a whole, as he points out a lot of interesting things we don't have time to cover here, as there's still one more thing I need to get out of my chest about Phantom Blood. I'm not a huge fan of experiencing stories that are created by the fans, but still, there are times where I play a game like Brutal Doom that builds upon what was already great about the original. The same can be said about Towa Nishinomade or Till We Eternally Rest, a fan-made manga about Phantom Blood that completely changes the events of the story. Spoilers for the second episode of JoJo's, if you want to avoid that, please refer to the timestamp I've set here. As most of you already know, in the beginning of the story, Dio rejects his humanity, and by using the stone mask, turns himself into a vampire. What this fan manga does is switch the roles, where the righteous man Jonathan Joestar instead is turned into a vampire and has to live with the craving of blood he has in himself, and the monster he has become. The story masterfully uses this concept and the characters of the original work to craft a breathtaking tale of love and compassion. We see a Jonathan who, due to his curse, has to live far from civilization, and the ones who once he called allies now turning against him in an alternate universe. The art is also pretty well done, and overall I feel like it's even a better story than Phantom Blood. As far as I know, the writer has only worked on JoJo projects. I have yet to read his other works, but I'm sure they're all great, as Till We Eternally Rest. Exactly a month after the end of Phantom Blood, the second part of JoJo's bizarre adventure called Battle Tendency was published in November of 1987. Part 1 of JoJo's faced quite the criticism back when it first came out, such as, and I quote, "the weakness of the main characters in the start, lack of female characters, depiction of violence against animals, and being boring compared to the likes of Captain Tsubasa and Dragon Ball," end quote. It was in part 2 when the series was finally able to distinguish itself from all the other shonen manga as a truly unique experience. JoJo's method of storytelling differed a lot from its contemporaries as the main characters totally changed with each new part. While most characters spent years building up their main cast, JoJo would do it in only a handful of volumes and constantly added interesting new characters to its story. Although this writing method isn't perfect and we see its glaring problems come up in part 3, I still feel like it adds a sense of freshness to the story that is unique to JoJo's. And speaking of story, let's talk about Battle Tendency. This time we're accompanied by Jonathan's grandson, Joseph Joestar, and by now it's become completely obvious where the name JoJo comes from. While Joseph's grandfather dealt with his problems by sheer force and power, he in turn is a lot more cunning and exploits each of his opponent's weaknesses to his advantage. No more is the story about who's stronger, but who's smarter and can better deceive his opponent. Joseph's character is also a lot more comedic and fun to watch, kinda reminding me of Spike. Not his goofiness of course, but how he portrays himself as someone not caring about others while sacrificing himself for his loved ones and the good of humanity in general. But I guess all JoJo's are kinda like that. One thing you've probably noticed from the footage is that everyone is goddamn buff, and that's because one of the main inspirations for JoJo was Fist of the North Star and the general muscular protagonist of that time. This kind of design is what JoJo is mainly known for, even though it's only seen in the first three parts as Mr. Araki deviated from it, which we will talk about in the future, but for now I feel like part 2 was where the word bizarre really found its meaning. You have half-naked stripper gods looking for a piece of jewel, Nazi cyborgs hooked to UV lights, and also a main protagonist whose main plan for defeating his enemies is running away from them. But none of them could even hope to reach the weirdness of JoJoStar. There are times where authors entwine the core message they want people to perceive with their work. There are times where we have to interpret our own meanings from stories. And right at the end, in a corner sits JoJoStar, which is so complicated that it makes the lore of Kojima games look like SpongeBob. I'm not lying when I say I've spent hours reading articles and watching videos just to decipher a little bit of the insanity that is JoJoStar and failed. Although words can do justice about explaining the reading experience of this madness, I'll still do my best. JoJoStar is actually divided into two halves in my opinion. The first half, which is genuinely well written, and so well written in fact that I wish some of its scenes were considered canon, and the latter half, which is basically like an acid trip without actually doing any drugs. As the title suggests, the story takes place somewhere between parts 1 and 2, where Joseph's father, JoJoStar, alongside his mother, Lisa, have to uncover the mystery surrounding one of their classmates' murders. The book masterfully depicts George and Lisa's relationship when they were children up to the point where they got married. Moreover, the book has some really interesting ideas about the parts Mr. Araki left out of the manga, like Dio and Erina surviving the shipwreck in the middle of the ocean, and explores their characters as a whole. Even one of my all-time favorite moments in JoJo also takes place in this book, and it's where Cars meets George in an alternate universe time travel black hole thingy that happens. Cars talking about his astonishment at humanity, at how we can easily create things that don't exist out of our creativity. How Cars, upon discovering our race, spent years reading our novels and wondered at the power of our minds, giving his decisions in the manga a lot more context. But as they say, all good things come to an end. And that's when the second part hits. I don't want to even pretend that I know anything about it, so I'm just going to recite one of the events, I repeat one of the events that happens in the second half. 920,000 copies of the skin of a zombie come together over an upside down England, and they have to fight the 37th version of Cars, and his stand is Made in Heaven Ultimate Requiem. Oh, and there's also a character called Funny Valentine, his son Funnier Valentine, and his grandson Funniest Valentine, which I thought I needed to share. These are all events that happen in the book, and I haven't made them up. More than anything, I commend the creativity of the author. As I said before, some of these ideas are neat, but I don't think it needed such an insane overarching plot to deliver them. Even worse is that I spent hours reading through it, hoping for a decent ending, which I didn't get. Don't go near JoJo's though, or at least abandon it halfway through, as the author didn't care, and nor should you. Before we move on to Stardust Crusaders, the last part we'll cover in this video, I feel like there's one other thing worth talking about while not entirely related to part 2, and that is JoJo's Bizarre Adventure All-Star Battle. Inspired by its predecessor JoJo's Venture, All-Star Battle is the first 3D JoJo fighting game, which was released in 2013. Although the game was met with mediocre reviews in the West, in its homeland, All-Star Battle managed to receive a 10 out of 10 from the Famitsu magazine, which honestly is a bit of a stretch in my opinion. I love JoJo, and despite having read all of the parts before playing it, I have to side with the Western critiques, as this game leaves a lot to be desired for. But this doesn't mean you can't have fun with it. It's clear that this game isn't designed for anything besides fan service, as the fighting mechanics themselves were pretty shallow. You have characters from all the 8 parts which you can choose freely and put against each other, plus a story that follows the manga and a store for which in place of points you can get official art of the game. As I've said, the most fun you'll have in the game is placing your favorite characters against each other and trying your damn hardest to bust some flashy moves which the game tries its best to impede. That's why I completely understand the difference of opinion between East and West, as I reckon the people who've grown up with JoJo would definitely appreciate its products more. In my opinion, hold this game for last to enjoy its best. As for the sequel, Eyes of Heaven, it's basically a modernized version of All-Star with 20 new additional characters, plus a story mode supervised by Mr. Araki himself. Although it's a lot more refined than its predecessor, the tedium that settles in after a few hours of play still exists, and I found myself enjoying watching its gameplay on YouTube a lot more than actually playing it. But the kick-ass soundtrack plus the amazing voice acting and story would at least guarantee you'll have a great time with it, whether watching or actually playing it. If you think of JoJo as a really long road, I know this metaphor is really weird, just bear with me, its third part Stardust Crusaders would probably be its biggest speed bump. A lot of JoJo fans such as myself believe that the first half of part 3 is kind of boring, and I completely understand if you reached this point and decided to give up. As I mentioned, this was where I thought about dropping the show. But the battle with the legendary Dio is just around the corner, and who wouldn't want to finish the first trilogy with that? Of course, this isn't to say that part 3 is bad or anything, I absolutely love it. It's just that the new battle system and art style might take a bit of getting used to, but after you've reached part 4, it's smooth sailing from there. But still, Stardust Crusaders is the foundation that part 4 onward have been built upon it, serving as a crucial point in the series as a whole. Our protagonist this time, unlike the ones before, is the hot-headed and brutal Jotaro. Jotaro Kujo not only has a more distinct design compared to previous JoJo's, but he has also inherited their best traits. Jonathan's might plus the cunningness of Joseph have made him a formidable foe in front of his opponents. However, he's not alone, as a whole group of dedicated fighters assist Jotaro in his quest for saving his mother, or humanity as a whole. The Crusaders are comprised of the charismatic Abdul, the likable clown Polnareff, the fearless calm member of the group Kakuin, the ever-vigilant Iggy, and also the main protagonist of the last part and grandfather of Jotaro, the lovable Joseph Joestar. All of these people traveling the world in hopes of finding Dio Brando and defeating him once and for all. The existence of Joseph and the fact that Dio has returned from the dead to be this part's antagonist gives the viewer this feeling that JoJo is a multi-generational tale that has cursed the Joestar family. But the Crusaders' design is far from perfect, as it was really difficult coming up with phrases to explain some of their characters. I'm talking about you, Abdul, in the previous segment, and I bet most of it had to do with everything being new territory for Mr. Rocky. Because aside from that, our characters don't fight with Hamon, aka Sankarati, but use a power called Stand. Quoting from JoJo Wiki, a stand is the physical manifestation of a person's life energy, which can take any form and is controlled by a stand user. They often appear to be humanoid and help their users in battle, but if they're injured in any way, the user also suffers the same injuries. If you look up the number of episodes or chapters of Stardust, you'll notice that it's significantly longer than Part 1 and 2 combined, and this is hugely due to the start of stand battles and the villain of the week style of the show. As I recall, Mr. Araki had stated, the stands were created with the idea of equating everyone in battle. No matter if someone's young or old or even an animal, stands grant them the ability to fight in equal footing, and that's what makes JoJo battles so fun to watch. Although Hamon kinda fulfilled this role too, as the story progressed, its usage became more and more limited, and that's when stands came into the scene. If you think about it, their potential is basically infinite, and something that even years later, Mr. Rocky is still experimenting with all the way in Part 8. However, this doesn't mean that all stands are good though. One of the major reasons Part 3 is so long is because Mr. Rocky was still trying out different ideas with this battle system. That's why we have a monkey controlling a ghost ship and a giant fly which blows up airplanes, both adding nothing to the overall story. Fortunately, this problem became less and less frequent as Mr. Rocky grew more comfortable with designing stands, resulting in some of my favorite encounters in the whole series. With the cancellation of the Phantom Blood movie, this wasn't the first time Studio Abb had handled the JoJo IP, as years before, they had made two OVAs based on the beginning and the end of Stardust. While the modern JoJo anime made by David Production tries its best to be as close to the manga as possible, by changing up the color palettes or using sound effects just like in the manga, the OVAs go for a much darker and real thing, which I absolutely love. The new anime is a lot more lighthearted and comedic, while the OVAs focus on the relationship between the Crusaders, their losses, their hardship, and the genuine feeling of solace they find in each other. Skip to this timestamp if you don't want to be spoiled. When you see Polnareff hugging Abdul as hard as he can, shedding tears when he finds out he's alive, there's a tangible sense of sadness and hope I have rarely felt, and these raw emotions are what makes the OVA so special for me. One other thing that surprised me was the character designs, most importantly, Jotaro's. Jotaro is as badass as he has ever been, and even more collected and cold-hearted than in the anime. His stand, Star Platinum, moves at the speed of light so you rarely see his figure, but when you do, you know shit's about to go down. The characters themselves are, a little wide, but besides that, everything looks clean. I commend them for trying to be as close to the original manga as possible while carving their own unique identity out of it. Definitely check it out if you like Star Crusaders. You thought there were no more JoJo games? Don't make me laugh. 1993 was definitely an amazing year for JoJo, as not only were they watching their favorite characters on TV, but they also had a full-on Star Crusaders game on the Famicom, simply titled JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, was released in 1993 made by the company Winkysoft, and surprisingly, I had a really fun time with it. You can pee in the game, which if you watch my Yakuza 2 video, you'll know that it's something I very much enjoy doing in video games, and for the 600 kilobit size, they've pretty much fitted all the major stand battles in the game, plus some original twists. The only problem I had was that much like the Phantom Blood game, it was pretty difficult, and I couldn't complete it even with cheats on, but if you really want to get your hands on more JoJo titles, your calculator can probably run this. Remember how I said 1993 was a good year for JoJo fans? Well, aside from a 6-episode OVA and a video game, they also got a novel based on Stardust Crusaders in the same year. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Genesis of the Universe, written by Mayuri Sekijima and Hiroshi Yamaguchi, was released in 1993 on Jump Novel. The story takes place somewhere between the two seasons of Stardust, where Jotaro and his group have to fight three strong sand users on their way to Dio. Three people who each in their own way have turned their back on civilization and fear from it, finding solace in the empty lies Dio has gave them. I love this premise, and the novel stays consistently exciting and interesting until the very end. But there's a huge but here, and that is, I felt like the writers hadn't fully understood their characters, especially the main cast. Like, there's this scene halfway throughout the book where Jotaro and Polnareff are stranded in the middle of the desert. It doesn't take long until they completely give up and fall on the sand. It's a pretty serious moment in the book, but Jotaro stares into two dunes, saying they remind him of his mother's bosom. Really? Like, really, Jotaro? Him? Like, seriously? It doesn't make any sense at all, and it might come across as nitpicking, but these really weird moments happen more than once in the book. But aside from that, Genesis has one of the most beautiful moments I've seen in JoJo. It isn't a particularly special scene, it doesn't serve that big of a purpose in the story, hell, it isn't even about our main characters. It's when Jotaro and Polnareff meet this old man in a village in the middle of nowhere, and he starts talking about happiness and being alone. He says, "If you don't want to spoil the desires you've grown in your hearts, might as well ignore reality and be happy anyway." I love this quote. It reminded me of my own life, where I was made fun of because I was too cooped up in my room playing video games, not socializing like the other kids, not playing outside, just doing my own thing, and it made it difficult for me to find friends. I've been alone for most of my life, but these past few years, especially planning to study abroad, meeting people online, finding friends, and talking about my hobbies, have made life so much fun, and JoJo reminded me of that. Of that things are gonna be okay, although they might not be now. And that's a lesson I'll cherish forever. Hi guys, this is the first time I'm recording one of these after the video segment thingies, and I have no script for it and I'm scared, but I made this to say thank you. Thank you for watching up until the end. You've stuck by it. Really means a lot to me, and I hope you've enjoyed the video. I certainly had a lot of fun making it. I really got emotional during some of its parts, both in writing the script and editing it. It's crazy. Think about how more than a year ago I started JoJo, and still that love has not disappeared, and more than anything, it's gone a lot more. So thank you for witnessing that, and if you did enjoy the video, consider liking, subscribing, commenting, do whatever you think it's best. And if you feel like this whole video, my style, and even this segment is reminiscent of Super Eye Patch Wolf, it's because it is. I'm basically a shittier version of him. So thanks for watching. I have two more videos in the works, but it probably be a while before I upload them, because 5 days from now I'm gonna move out of my country and go to Canada. So I have tons of stuff I need to do, but I'll get them out as soon as possible. Thank you. Have a nice day, afternoon, evening, whatever, and see ya.